I'm Tom Jukes. I'm the founder of CyberEye. I also teach cybersecurity at the University of Arizona. I have a master's degree in cybersecurity and several industry certifications.
And my name is Dan Gavin, and I'm a cyber guy. I have a master's in computer engineering and several industrial certifications for cybersecurity. And together we are
the cyber guys
from CyberEye. That's who we are. So welcome.
I love it.
Hey, Tom, why don't you tell us a little bit about, how you got into this business?
Sure. When I started teaching at the University of Arizona, it was back in 2017, and I was doing a lot of research in the cybersecurity industry. And so I was contacted by a whole bunch of different vendors, and as I was interviewing with them, I was asking them, what do you do for small and medium-sized businesses? Because I got the feeling from them they were trying to get into the university, big ecosystem. And their response was, we don't do anything for small businesses. They don't have a big enough budget, and there's just no way they could afford our expensive software. So
they're just out of luck.
Small businesses are out of luck.
Until
CyberEye. So I did a lot of research, and I found a suite of tools that I could put together and create something that was affordable to small, medium-sized businesses, but it gives them at least as good a capability as they would get from, a government level or a big industry level cybersecurity suite. So one of the things that I discovered when I was researching was a Verizon data breach report produced every year by Verizon, the big cell phone company. One of the things that I saw that I was really surprised by was that small businesses were the target. There's a big bullseye painted right on the small businesses. Why is that? Honestly, when I talk to small businesses and they tell me that they're not the target, well, they are the target because, number one, they have a small budget, which is what we just discussed, they have a small budget. And so they're not allocating resources to cybersecurity. And so because their security posture is so low, it's easy pickings for the bad guys.
So they're a soft target for the hackers.
Soft target, well said.
Firewalls and antivirus. So they're going to say, I got my antivirus. I'm good to go.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So the way antivirus works, think of it like this. It's kind of like in the summertime, you're barbecuing, you're going outside, in and out the sliding glass door, and one of those trips in and out, a fly gets in. And it flies around, and it lands on your food, and nobody wants flies on their food. So what do? What do you grab?
Get the fly swatter out.
You get the fly swatter. Now, when you've, everybody's used a fly swatter. Do you walk around following the fly, swatting at it while it's in the air?
No.
You wait for it to land on some flat surface, so you get a good swat at it. Now, you can swat at it while it's in the air, but it's totally ineffective. And, half the time you're following the fly around the house waiting for it to land, and suddenly it disappears. Because they're tiny, and they're random. Flies are like malware. They sneak in through an open door. The open door is your browser and your email. That's how they get in. And then they fly around inside the memory of your computer. Well, antivirus can't see it while it's in memory. Antivirus has to wait for it to land on the disk, horizontal surface. Soon as it lands on the disk, now the antivirus can get a signature and compare it to its database, but not while it's in the air. In the air, it's in memory. And that's where most advanced malware resides, is in memory. Can't be seen by antivirus.
Okay. Now, what if I got this cool sonic wall firewall?
Oh,
I'll be protected then,
oh
right?
Yeah. Well, the sonic wall firewall protects you from all the scanning attempts coming from China and Russia and North Korea. But we're not worried about those. Problem is, the firewall has a hole in it. And it's the hole that your browser and your email use. And so that's where the flies get in, through that gaping hole in your firewall. So it doesn't matter how much money you spend on your firewall. They all have the same gaping hole. The exact same hole.
Yeah, if you want internet access, you got to have that hole.
Got to have a hole in the firewall, yeah.
You want to use your browser or your email.
Or your email. Same
otherwise
hole.
You're safe.
Yep.
Does that make sense?
Does that make sense?
Oh, does boy. That make sense? Yeah, it does. What would you say the biggest problem is for small, medium-sized businesses?
Well, I say it, and Verizon says it, and CrowdStrike says it, and MITRE says it. Everybody says it. The biggest problem today is ransomware.
Ransomware.
Hands down, ransomware. And there are two reasons for that. One, ransomware is getting a lot smarter and easier to use. That's one. I know it sounds like two, but it's one. Smarter and easier to use. Because of that second one, because it's getting easier to use, we now have a lot more cyber criminals. We have big crime organizations, syndicated crime organizations. And what's worse, they are combining and working together. One of the ways that ransomware has gotten easier to use is referred to as ransomware as a service. Think of it like Netflix. It's kind of like Netflix. Is Netflix easy for you to use?
Yep, point and click.
Yeah.
Find out where I want to go. Watch that movie.
As easy as Netflix is for you to use, ransomware as a service is that easy for anybody to attack with ransomware.
So in the past, it used to be the crime syndicates with the big money were the only ones who could do this. Mm-hmm. But now the crime syndicates are making even more money by offering this service to the rest of the criminals and hacks that
Absolutely.
Normally would not have been able to do this.
Absolutely. If your grandma can use Netflix, she can deploy ransomware. Hmm.
Okay. This goes south then.
You know?
Who knows?
Who knows? Right. Maybe we'll get grandma doing ransomware if this doesn't go anywhere.
Let's hope not. All right. All right. So the big question is, how do you protect yourself? So now it's everybody's out there after you. You got two gaping holes in there. The malware doesn't land on your disk anymore. It actually goes out in a script and goes out to the internet that's wide open, pulls down its payload, and encrypts your stuff. So how do you protect yourself?
Well, it's called the malware paradox. Malware wants to do two things. One, it wants to hide, and that's the fly flying around in the memory. Wants to hide. Number two, it needs to execute. And so malware finds many different ways to execute, but it always has to execute. And as soon as it executes, it can be discovered. I have two dogs. I have a dog named Daisy, big, white, fluffy, loves everybody. Everybody that comes to the door is Daisy's friend. She doesn't even have to know them. They're her friend. I have another little dog. His name's Chase. He's a little black curly dog. And to Chase, nobody's a friend. Except for the five people that live in the house.
Yeah.
And so when Daisy loves everybody, that's called there's the known good list and the known bad list.
Yep.
Daisy has a known bad list and it's empty. And that's antivirus. That's how antivirus works. Antivirus has a database of known bad programs. And it looks at all the programs on your computer to see if any of those programs match its known bad list. But as we already talked about, malware, most of it resides in memory and doesn't touch a disk. And so the antivirus cannot get a signature on it. So therefore, it's not going to see it. The other one, the little black dog, he is a known good list, and he has five people on his list. Everybody else is bad. See, Chase doesn't have to know who's bad because Chase knows who's good. And he assumes everybody else is bad. And that's where we need to get. And that's where CyberEye is today. We have a mechanism to turn your computer into Chase. And we create a list of what we know is good. You really only have, I mean, if you make a list of the programs you use on a day-to-day basis, maybe 10, maybe a dozen at the most, right? And so if we just list those and we say, those are allowed to run, nothing else can run, then it doesn't matter whether the fly is in the memory or on the disk, it doesn't matter. As soon as it tries to execute, it's denied.
Right.
Because there's no policy, right? This is all policy-based. There's got to be a list. If you're not on the list, you don't run.
Okay. So if I have a malware script and it downloads, I go out to the internet and get my payload. Can I even do that?
Well, that's a great question. So here's how it works. You get an email and it has a PDF, and the PDF is weaponized. The PDF tries to open a tool called PowerShell. PowerShell is a scripting tool. It's baked into every Windows operating system. And with PowerShell and administrative privileges, you can do anything you want. And so malware always goes straight for PowerShell. Well, what we have to do is build a box around PowerShell. And then the little list, the chase list, the known good list, we simply delete everything from that list. And we say nothing can open PowerShell. So PowerShell simply won't open. And we refer to that as ring fencing.
What's the story with ring fencing? I'm not sure I understand that totally now. Can you explain it?
Sure. It's kind of like this. When we were first married and started having babies, the babies were great when they were laying on the blanket, but eventually they started to roll, and then they started to crawl, and then they started to get into things, right? And as soon as we did that, my wife went down to Target and bought these child safety locks and went into the kitchen and put them on all the cabinets that had dangerous things in them, right? Under the sink, we keep the dish soap. Dish soap is great for washing dishes. You have to get to it, right? But the babies don't need to get to it. So we locked up the dish soap. The dish soap is like PowerShell. It has a specific use, a specific purpose. Should be used by specific people at specific times. That's what PowerShell is. And the way your operating system is right now, Windows is wide open. You can open PowerShell whenever you want, do whatever you want with it. So we just put child safety locks on PowerShell.
Ring fencing is child safety locks for those have to get to. Because sometimes your IT administrators have to run PowerShell scripts.
They do.
Sometimes they do. But now they'll be able to run only those scripts, and no weaponized Word document or PDF will be able to use it.
That's right.
Or link that you click.
Yeah, if they have 3 or 4 or 10 PowerShell scripts, we just create the known good list and we say, these are good. Everything else is bad.
We have ring-fenced PowerShell.
Yep. And run DLL and a lot of other baddies.
Okay.
A lot of other powerful tools that malware tries to leverage against you.
I see a lot of clients and a lot of small business, you know, they don't have an IT department, but they usually, you know, hire out some IT people. And they say, why do I need cybersecurity? My IT guys can do this.
That is a great question. Think of it like this. You have a family doctor, and the family doctor does all of your frequent visits. You get a cold, you get the flu, you get a fever, you get an infection, you go to the family doctor. And for the most part, they're able to take care of all those things. What if you go to the family doctor because you're having heart issues. Your heart just kind of feels funny, so you go to the family doctor and he checks you out, or she checks you out, does an EKG and says, you know, I don't like the looks of this EKG. I want you to go to a specialist. So you go to your cardiologist, right? Why don't you stay with your family doctor? Because your family doctor is not a heart specialist. When you have something as critical as your heart, you go to a specialist. You don't mess around. Your computers and your network for your business, that's the heart of your business. Can you imagine what would happen if suddenly you came in and they were gone? Your business would die, let's be honest. And so your IT person is absolutely critical for day-to-day tasks. Fixing printers, fixing the internet issues, whatever it may be, the day-to-day things. Their job, their focus, is to keep the assets available. It's called availability. That's their job. The security professional, their job is to keep the assets safe. Available versus safe.
So the IT guy's job is functionality. So he'll get it done however it needs to get done, mm-hmm. He'll get it done.
And keep everything up and running.
But it might not be protected.
That's right.
So what we do at CyberEye is we take that balance of protection of your data and your network and functionality.
That's right. And we work with the IT person. We are hand in glove. This is the same way your family doctor works with the cardiologist.
Another thing that I hear some people say is, I've been in this business for 20 years and I haven't got hacked yet. Why should I get cybersecurity now? Why should I care about cybersecurity now?
That's a great question. Well, it's kind of like this. Do you drive a car?
Yes.
Do you wear a seatbelt?
Of course.
Have you ever been in an accident?
No.
Okay. Then why do you wear a seatbelt? Then, and do you have auto insurance?
Yes.
Why do you have auto insurance? You've never been in an accident.
Well, my wife drives.
That's a bad joke. You can.
My kids drive.
See, you can control you. You can't control everybody around you. That's why you need to worry about this. Just because you haven't had a breach in the past 10 years does not mean you're not going to get a breach in the future. What is it they say on the prospectus on you, when you're talking to a financial advisor?
Yeah, past performance is not an indicator of future
results or something like that. Yeah, brilliant. It's the same thing. Just because you haven't been hacked in the past, you will be hacked in the future. It's a matter of probability. We have smarter ransomware that's easier to use and more people doing it. It's a law of large numbers. It's going to happen.
It is. And I've been, in all the reports I've been seeing, we see in the last 3 years, in the last two especially, but ransomware has grown exponentially. Mm-hmm. So over 60% of the businesses reported that they had a breach.
Right.
And those are only the ones that report.
It's underreported. It's only the big ones reporting. Small businesses simply don't report. They don't want anybody to know they've been hit. So they pay the Bitcoin, they mop up the mess, they do the best they can and try to get back in business.
So within the next 10 years, the probability of any business getting hit with ransomware or having a breach of some kind is almost 100%.
I would absolutely say that. Yeah, well over 99.
What do you say to people that it's too expensive?
Well, it is really expensive depending on who you pick for your cybersecurity expert consultant. We were talking about the cost of a ransomware breach. Number one, probability of getting hacked within the next 10 years, nearly 100%. It's going to happen. What's the cost of it? Well, if you have to pay the ransom, you're looking at least $190,000. At the very minimum, we've seen them recently as much as $500,000 to get the decryption keys. It's no laughing matter. So if you figure you're going to be in business for another 10 years, and you know that the probability of getting hit with ransomware in the next 10 years is nearly 100%, well, and you take the smallest number, $190,000, average that out over 10 years, it's $19,000 a year. It's $1,500 a month, roughly. So that's the cost of the breach. So you can go that route.
Well, that's not even including the notification that people have, the identity theft monitoring, the recovery, the forensic investigation, the coaching, things like that.
That's right. Imagine you came into work tomorrow morning and all of your computers were a smoldering ash heaps and all the backups, because you've got backups devices plugged in and they're all gone too. How long would it take you to get back up and running so you could serve customers? A day? Could you just go down to Best Buy and buy a bunch of computers off the shelf and come back and plug them in and now you can serve your customers again? What about payroll? What about swiping credit cards? What about...
Could you pass an IRS audit?
Could you? If all those files were gone and you got audited, do you have a backup somewhere? Man.
About lost income?
So
you're down for 3 days. How much money does your business lose?
Most businesses are 2 weeks.
Oh.
2 weeks you can't serve customers. So how much do you make for 2 weeks? So you could do the math. What's your lost revenue for 2 weeks? It's two people, $150 an hour for 2 weeks to clean up. So do the math there, you know, $20,000 or so, plus your lost revenue, plus the Bitcoin, $190,000 on the low end, and plus everything you said, breach notification, that's easily $7 a patient if you're a dentist or a doctor. So you're pushing $500,000. And if you average that over the next 10 years, you plan on being in business. Do the math. I mean,
10 years, $50,000?
Yeah. A year. Yeah. A year. Yeah. Yeah. So you're easily, I mean, if you spent, as long as you spend less than $10,000 a month, tax deductible, by the way, most likely, because it's a business expense. Yeah. Why don't you talk about the offer?
All right. So the offer, like we just talked about. So, for 10 devices, most small, medium sized business, 10 devices, we have the CyberEye Locker product that will stop. That's your ring fencing and your known good. Only the known good can work.
It's the chase list.
It is the chase list. It's the ransomware protection, basically. And for 10 devices, and that would be value based on just your $190,000 Bitcoin over a 10-year period, that would be $1,499 a month. That would be a value of $1,499 a month. If that was all we were giving you, you would be better off. Number one, it's tax deductible. Mm-hmm. And number two, you don't have to worry about anything else. But that's not all. We also have when we go through, why don't you talk about the unified software audit that we have. And that's a value of $249. What do you do there?
The CyberEye Locker software sits on the computer and learns what's running. It learns all the files that are running. And then it creates a policy. It creates that known good list. And then at the end of about 7 days running, we look through all the policies that were created. And most of the policies we see are normal Windows processes, normal Windows executables. Spreadsheets and Word documents and all those things are being accessed. But some policies are strange because the CyberEye tool's never seen those before. And so those are the policies we want to look at. And that's where we'll find malware running.
So you do a basic review of what's going on. And after a week of this being on the system, you do a review of what software is actually running and what you actually want to keep running and what you want to stop running.
That's right.
That's what it is. All right. So next on our list, my favorite. Here you go. 30 days. Because it's so important to train your people and to have people understand what cybersecurity is, we're offering 30 day, an ebook, 30 Days to Better Cybersecurity, written by the two of the best cybersecurity authors I think that are out there.
You know, I have to agree with you, Dan.
Yeah.
I think it's definitely a good read.
All right. And it is at a high level. This is not geek speak there. We're talking when we wrote this book, we're talking to business owners. We're talking to the everyday people that don't know geek speak. And if you could take that and action those things that we talk about in there, you'll protect your business.
That's really a problem with a lot of cybersecurity related articles, is it's so technical that the layperson just doesn't get it. And so we fixed that.
The other thing we'll give you is a lot of times your IT department, like we said before, is focused on functionality, availability, making things work, right? But we have a product here, 20 cybersecurity webs, must-have websites for your IT people. So what it'll do with those websites, they'll be available for your IT personnel to review and look at, so they can get cybersecurity focused rather than just functionality focused.
And that's really critical, because that's who we work with. We work with the IT people to make sure that things stay running, but they stay running in a secure way. And when they have the same perspective, then the teamwork is better, the synergy is better. Like your family doctor working with the cardiologist,
Or peanut butter and jelly.
Peanut butter and jelly, even better.
All right, next we have, all right, so to keep you updated on what's going on in your network, we offer a customized monthly report just for you so you can see exactly what's going on in your network there. But that's not all. And hold on, does that make sense?
Does that make sense for
you to know all about that? All right, but that's not all. One other thing we have is a risk assessment. So what we'll do is we'll go in and review with you. We'll collaborate with the customer, you the customer, on what's important to you, what critical assets you have, and
what are you worried about? Yep. What's most important to protect? Where's your data?
Right. We'll take a look at where your threats are coming from, things like that.
This risk assessment is really about you. It's about you, the customer. It's about you and your assets and keeping your business protected.
Exactly. Now, if we added all that up, that would be a $2,034 value.
That's a bargain.
That is a deal because it's cheaper than $50,000 a month. But it's not about that. We got into this business to take care of the small, medium-sized business owner.
So if we were charging $2,034 a month, that's what everybody else is.
That's what the big boys are doing.
Yeah.
But we're taking care of the small, medium-sized business owners. So we're offering it to you for only $297 a month. That's a deal.
That's...
The savings are huge.
That's pennies.
Yeah. Ganga deal. Ganga deal. How many cups of coffee a day would that be?
Well, at Starbucks, that's like a cup and a half, $297. Isn't that how much a Starbucks coffee is? Yeah,
$5. Yeah, two cups a day.
Yeah. Paul, how much is a Starbucks coffee? Oh, he didn't know. Okay.
So buy now. Click the button below. Click get yours.
Click the button before it's too late, because it's going to be too late. It's going to be too late.
Yeah. All right.
It's already been too late for a lot of businesses. So, there was something that I didn't mention earlier. Is getting hit twice. I read a news report just a couple weeks ago. A big business. Suffered a ransomware infection, paid the Bitcoin, got the decryption key, cleaned up, but they didn't figure out what the attack vector was, how the ransomware got in. They didn't figure it out and close that hole. A week later, same ransomware from the same criminal hit the same company, and they had to pay again.
They love repeat customers, just like we do.
And you don't get a discount. For being a repeat customer.
And it's not tax deductible.
Most likely not. You have to talk to your accountant to find out for sure. Or your lawyer.
Oh, yeah. So you gotta take care of your business first. Does that make sense?
That makes sense, Dan.
All right.